Welcome to Keeping N Landscapes Blooming. We're from SAP, as you can see there. I'm Andreas Heikes. I've been with SAP for 17 years, working Cloud Foundry for 2.5 years.
Warm welcome from myself as well. Martin Schroeder, besides that, the same attributes as Andreas, working on the same project since the same time. Yeah, and I think that's the last talk between you and lunch, so I would say let's gonna go.
Okay. Okay, probably whom we represent today, mostly, of course, our team. So we are across 4 locations, and we also represent this number of virtual machines which are live in our landscapes. That are numbers from September, so I guess they're up again since then. What do we want to talk about? I heard the term landscape a couple of times today, so maybe it's not that exotic, but not everybody calls a CF installation a landscape, and we just want to show a little bit why do we call the stuff we have landscapes and landscape gardeners. Second part is the working mode, so how do we actually run the platform, how do we bring in the new features and versions from the colleagues from development there. And the third section is probably, let's say the most tangible, it's the monitoring and the tool selection we have to really run the stuff. Okay, landscape gardening and Cloud Foundry. So when you think landscape gardening, you probably think greenfield project, you can do what you want, but probably the moment you really stand there on that area, you realize there are a lot of boundary conditions like the terroir, the climate, and also, of course, the customer who wants to have a new landscape or a new garden from you. They have a certain budget, they have certain requirements, they want flowers, you want to grow crops or so on. You somehow have to get all of this stuff together, and you suddenly realize that a greenfield project is not that greenfield after all. Once you have set up the stuff and to all the requirements and all the needs and have it there, you realize that the real work starts from then, right, to keep that all blooming and keep that running. And of course, you know that there are external forces that are not easy to control, so you try to build in some resilience. You think about, okay, how do I water the garden? How can I provide shade for plants? How can I protect against snails and bugs creeping into that, and so on. So you try to provide the resilience, to plan the resilience, to test it, and so on. But in the end, at some times, disaster will strike. Right? Things will get broken, things won't work, and so on. And at these points, normally, you as a team or as a gardener, you are also challenged, right? Fixing your garden in a thunderstorm is much worse than fixing it in a lovely Sunday afternoon or so on. So basically, important for us also for the analogy is that you have to build in resilience in your team, in your processes and so on. You cannot build a garden on just edge work load and so on. That just doesn't work for yourself. Looking on the positive side, I think if you think garden, if you think a park or so on, that's hopefully for everybody a good thought, a positive picture, and that should also be the landscapes that you provide for your customers and stakeholders and developers. People should like to work with the platform. That should be a good place to go. So that is the Anspruch, the challenge we put to ourselves. That's what we want to provide. And of course, we also want to have commercial results, right? A garden or let's say a more a farm or so on, of course, needs to yield commercial results. So these are, let's say, the analogies where we see that's fitting for us quite nicely. Okay. The working mode we have for our team and how we started that. Basically, in January 2015, we started with Cloud Foundry, so that was new to all of us in our team. We started in 2 locations, Waldorf and Levallois, close to Paris. And we got a kickstart with the developers who already worked on that within SAP. And that worked quite nicely. And already in April 2015, we had the first commercial landscape running, including SLAs, a maintenance calendar, announcement channels, lots of really, really good discussions with the customer. So it's been running ever since. We heard this term multi-cloud a couple of times already today. So in October 2015, we had the next landscapes running, and that was on AWS. The first one was on OpenStack within the sub-data center, or one sub-data center, and 2015 in October, that was Amazon, and now in 2017 we look at several OpenStack flavors. We have AWS, Azure, GCP all there. And if you look at the other tags we have there, thinking about the Greenfield project, which is not so Greenfield after all, there are a couple of also other qualities we need to put into the landscape. Right, so compliance is a very important topic for the range of business we are in that needs to be there, and it had to be there right from the start. We decided in the organization for a bi-weekly update, latest bi-weekly update of things, of course, hot fixes, security patches, and so on, coming in even faster. So these are things that had to work across all platforms and all landscapes that we run. Looking at the speed we have there, that also sometimes mean for us as an operations team, we have to bite the bullet and do manual processes to keep things quickly coming in. And yeah, I'll come to that in a minute again. When we talk about landscapes, Cloud Foundry landscapes, so what's the bill of material, what's in there? I think the pictures speak for themselves. You know most of the icons there. The SAP icon is a placeholder for a lot of SAP-specific applications and so on in there. And basically, this bill of material we deploy to many landscape, to many installations across the globe, basically with small variations. Sometimes you have more components in there, sometimes you have less in there, and of course the configuration and the sizing is different per landscape. What we have in addition, and that's, let's say, more on the sole decision of our team, is what do we use to actually run the central tooling? What do we do to really monitor and run the landscapes for ourselves? And that's going to be in the second part of the presentation. Okay. So how do we organize our working day or working mode? So basically with the three time zones, we are a really distributed team, 25 people, and our most important task is to keep the systems running so that the live site is up, that the requests from customers are fulfilled, that the updates get in there. All of this needs to be done all the time, and that is the top priority. Even if it's sometimes cumbersome, you have interesting other things, that is the top priority. And that, of course, scales with the number of landscapes and the number of customers and the sizing you have. So basically, if you don't want to increase the number of operators all the time, you somehow have to balance the cost that you have per landscape. So when we look at how much time and energy we have as a team, we somehow have to balance that. On the one hand, you have this keep the system running, and we counter that with improvements in our process. So we look at the stuff, we are one team, so we know where it hurts. So basically we see, okay, where are the points where what are the issues that we need to tackle? Where do we need better automation? Where do we need better reporting? What are the alerts that keep us busy, but are either a false alert or are flapping or whatever? So that's where we try to invest in our team and say, okay, these are things we fix. And these improvements are mostly for our own team. So people outside don't see it. They probably see that we are more relaxed or less relaxed or so on, but that's mostly within our own team. And the third thing where we can invest into, that's what we call innovation. And that's where we basically say, okay, what do we change in our processes and tools that have an impact immediately on the people who use our landscape? So for example, for developers, how can we make their life easier with the live landscapes? For the people who do QA or do demos or whatever on the landscapes, what do we need to do that they feel comfortable and can request things? Instead of doing a ticket, they can just do a self-service. Instead of asking us for status, they can just check it themselves in the system. So these are, whenever we have backlog items in our Kanban board, they fall in one of the three categories that we have here. And so we try, as product owners, we try to balance that. Our goal would be that 40% of our energy goes in to keep the systems running. Honestly, right now it's probably around 60%. And with a fast adoption of the platform and the increased usage there, we are just busy keeping these numbers somehow stable. Challenging, but good. Okay, we are not alone in this world, which is good. So we have a lot of other teams that we work with together at SAP. So when we look at it, we as a team are certainly the generalists. So we know the whole landscape, we know a lot of the processes around that and so on. And staying with this landscape analogy, when we see that a crop is not looking well, we can water it, we can put in fertilizer or so on, but we might also see that there's no help with that and we directly call the specialists. So development teams who know their components very well, but probably not the other components. So that's us who have to do the first aid to the landscape and then get in the specialist to really do the deep analysis and then either provide a fix or develop with us a workaround to keep things stable. And then again, we see the different focus of us and the development teams. So we have the right now focus. We must keep the landscape running right now. There's no denial of that. We have to do it. And if that is painful, if that's manual work, okay, happens, but it buys the development teams the time to do the real fixing. And that's where we see the, let's say, the separation of concerns or separation of duties and so on, and that works quite well. It also means for us, we have to be open for the new improvements that come, so sometimes they're probably wild ideas and it needs some time for us to adapt to that and so on, but that is the idea, right? So some of the changes are bigger, are different, really challenge the way we work and so on, and we have to get that. I would need a swagger for the fly. We have to adapt these changes and we have to think together with development teams, how do we best get that in? So while we still stabilize the landscape manually, the developers have the time to do something else, roll that out, and try with us to bring that innovation into the landscape. While we share the common goal of having, let's say, a stable, attractive landscape for the customers, we have this different focus right now, whether it's, let's say, long-term or improvement of features and so on. So how do you work with that in everyday life? One thing is, of course, close collaboration in there so that we really have the direct means to get the development teams in there when there are problems coming up. It also means working together on the backlog so that we have this feedback from outside the lab, that we can provide that to development teams because we see what's happening on the live landscapes a lot. That is one thing. The other thing is, of course, also that we ask the development teams to give us hands-on sessions before that we roll out new features together, that we do critical updates together and so on. Yeah, I guess that is needed to really build the trust so that we just say, yeah, every 2 weeks you have something new, we put it in. Don't worry about it. Thursday morning, the stuff will go into the systems. We will do that for you. So that is the one thing that the development teams can rely on and we can rely on that they're there to support that. One of the things, I mean, a lot of times you sit together during outages. That's when we provide the cookies and the chocolate. But that should not be the only time that we sit together. So sometimes there's this notion of celebrate small success, and that's probably that doesn't happen often enough. That's always, I guess, something that falls short in that. But it does happen from time to time. And there are a lot of good pieces where we see really the improvements coming on really in small iterations, step by step. Okay, basically that would wrap up my part here on the collaboration and the working mode, and then I hand over to Martin for the right side of the landscapes.
In the second part of our presentation, I would like to show you how we actually monitor the system and which tools we use for that one. But before that, let's first go back to our analogy of the garden. So if you look at the left-hand side tomato plant, would you say, is that one healthy? Rather looks like yes. And the right one, is it healthy? Not really, right? So for a tomato plant, it's rather easy to see whether it's healthy or not. Unfortunately, for a Cloud Foundry landscape consisting of, let's say, hundreds of applications and components, it's a bit more difficult than just looking at the landscape. So, of course, we have the Bosch Health Manager. You could ask the Health Manager, what is the status of the VMs? Bosch will tell you the truth, I guess. But unfortunately, Bosch Health Manager and the VM status doesn't tell you anything about how the customer actually perceives the landscape. So even if all the VMs are up and running and if all the jobs are running, it still could be that the scenario for the customer is still not working. So what we did is we basically focused at the very beginning on black box monitoring from outside. So on the left-hand side, you see all our landscapes mentioned by Andreas. So we have various landscapes. And what we do is we have our Jenkins, therefore the name Landscape Gardening, because the host name of that thing is Landscape Gardener. And what we do is we defined a couple of scenarios which are simulating end user activities on the platform. So we don't look at technical components like VM status on is the app instance running, are two out of three instances running, or all of them. That's interesting, but from the endpoint, from the end customer point of view, not really interesting. So we simulate end user scenarios. One scenario which we have is we call it the developer scenario. So we are simulating typical activities of a developer. A developer is pushing an application, creating a backing service, binding that one to an application, viewing the logs of the application, starting the application, stopping the applications, doing other stuff. So that's what a typical developer with Cloud Foundry is doing. So we define that scenario, and we have a Jenkins which is firing that scenario on a regular basis against all the landscapes. So with that one, we would be able to see whether at all point in time a developer is able to work with our Cloud Foundry landscapes, being it on AWS, Google, our own data center, wherever. So that's what we do with our monitoring from end point of view, and we do it as a black box. So we don't care about the details, whether it's 200 VMs, 300, whether 10 of them are running or not, but we try to look from the customer point of view. We did that at the very beginning with growing scale, growing interest of our landscapes. We had the issue that we had only the Jenkins, so the job status or the availability of the landscape was visible in Jenkins itself. So who of you know Jenkins or have worked with Jenkins? Quite a lot of them. So doing user management on job level on Jenkins, it's rather technical. So you can do that to some extent, but at some point in time, you're just doomed. So what we decided to do is we tried to decouple the actual status visualization from the execution of the monitoring. So that was a point in time where we introduced an InfluxDB and a Grafana instance to just tell Jenkins, yes, you do the execution, but the status of your job execution, this is something you report to InfluxDB, and we have a Grafana on top of it, where everybody can look at the status. So that one, and that's another thing where we said that's very important for us, is the availability of the landscape should not be a secret to somebody in the company. That should be public, everybody should be able to see it. It should be us as an operations team, it should be the developer, it should be the management, whoever in the company who should be able to see the status. That's something we don't want to hide, but of course you want to hide the details in the Jenkins. So that's why we decoupled it. How that looks like in real time or in detail, so that's a screenshot of our Grafana dashboard. What you see here is, I think I can't go far away from the mic. So on every tile, that's one of our landscapes. So that's the overview showing the status of all of our landscapes. The good news here is we have a lot of green tiles, which means many of our landscapes are just running fine. But you see, for example, a yellow one on the top left. That means, well, the names are a bit anonymized for legal reasons, but that landscape seems to have an issue because it's yellow, it's not green. The yellow means, not sure whether you can read the text on it, but yellow for us means that landscape is either not a real-life productive landscape, so it could be a staging landscape internally, or maybe it is a monitoring scenario which we don't rate as prior one. So in that case, a tile here would turn yellow. Luckily, we don't have a red tile over here, but if a landscape would turn red, that means it's a real-life productive landscape, and it is a prior one scenario which is failing. So for example, the developer scenario, that's prior one. So if you can't work with Cloud Foundry as a developer, we have a serious issue. So a tile here would turn red. So that dashboard over here would give us the overview of all of our landscapes. That's nice to get an overview, but yeah, if you see there's a red or a yellow landscape, you would like to see details. So what you do, you just click on the tile, and you come to the next slide, dashboard. You see all the details. Now each tile is one monitoring scenario which we run against the landscape. So that's one level down. So that's all the different monitoring scenarios we have covering certain scenarios and use cases for our platform. And then you would see the detail, okay, the landscape was red or yellow, and why was it red? Because the developer scenario wasn't working, or pinging the Cloud Foundry API wasn't working, or I don't know, the authentication wasn't working. So you would see the details, what's actually not working in the landscape. And then for some teams or team members or some people, the next level down would be if you click on the yellow tile in that case, you would again end up in our Jenkins. So this would be a step we in our operations team could do. Some other people would have permissions as well, but many other people would be blocked here because they shouldn't access Jenkins, should see the details. But for people who have the permissions, could even go to the Jenkins execution. You would see the overall log. You could re-trigger the monitoring so that you say, okay, I fixed the issue, or maybe it was just a temporary hiccup, so I re-trigger the monitoring execution and could check whether it's green now or still have an issue. But that's the division we did, that we separate these availability and the transparency of the landscape from the actual monitoring execution, so that ideally everybody is able to see at any point in time, are our landscapes healthy or not. Another example, unfortunately, that screenshot isn't that nice. So imagine you would see tiles on here. So it's rather similar to the previous one. Again, one tile for all the landscapes. But that dashboard over here is showing you the deployment status. So we have various landscapes on various infrastructure layers, and we have one product version. But keeping all those landscapes in sync is not that easy. So a most often called question in our company would be, okay, there's a product version XYZ, and do I have all that product version on all of our landscapes? So we use Concourse for automatic deployment, but still it might take some time until all the updates are on all the landscapes. So people want to see which version of the product is running on which landscape. Or there was a critical security hotfix which we need to deploy. So people want to know, is that hotfix, has it already reached all the landscapes? Or do I need to cover some landscape? Or do I need to trigger the deployment? So that's an important information. And again, the same paradigm, it's open to everybody. Operations people should see it, development people should see it, delivery management, product management, whoever wants to see the information should be able to easily get that status. We have combined that with a couple of more informations. So for example, if you take that Azure hotfix on the bottom left corner, there's some red text over here which is telling you the status of some deployments is failing. So as I said, we are using Concourse for deployment, but you don't want to use the Concourse UI for all of your landscapes, so you don't want to browse through different Concourse installations and UIs, but that's the overview. So it would tell you, okay, some of your deployments in that landscape is failing, so the landscape would turn red. Some text on that slide is yellow. Yellow in that case means the landscape is either not on the latest product version, so there is no error, but it's, let's say, outdated, or there is a change on the configuration of the landscape, but that change hasn't been applied to the landscape yet, or the deployment is still running. So that you could see, okay, I did the change already, whatever that is, but it's not yet applied to the landscape. And again, the details, if you would click on one of the tiles, then you actually see the landscape. So it's again our bill of material in a tabular manner. And then you would see in that case, there was one service in our platform, and the deployment of that service is failing. So that's the details on here. And that's basically the two scenarios I wanted to show you today, so how we monitor the landscapes. One is the availability monitoring, sorry for that. and the other one is the deployment status of all our landscapes, because at least we currently see a growing number of landscapes which we have, and keeping that in sync and easily seeing the overview and keeping track of them is one of the major challenges for us. So what's next in the next planting season? Coming soon. So currently we rather focus on black box monitoring, which is nice because it simulates end user activities. The drawback of that one is if we see the landscape threat, the customer sees it as well because we already have an issue. So it's rather reactive. So we only see it if the issue is already there. So what we want to do is we would like to have extend that with a white box monitoring. So we try to get more insights from the landscape. So we have an ELK stack in the landscape. We have a lot of logs of the different components. We have the Bosch Health Manager. We have the Cloud Foundry Health Manager. So there are many components. which we could use as a kind of early warning system. So if they report some issue, still the scenario for the end customer could be working. But we get some information upfront that we can react before some customer scenarios are down. So that's one of the next things we want to do, extending black box with white box to get insights earlier and be more proactive, not just react if it's already down. And the other thing and the other wish and hope we would have is today we shared our experiences with you. And we have seen that there is a sea of operators community, but it's not really active. But we would like to share our experiences with you and would hope for ideas, experiences from your side. Because I guess among you, who's operating Cloud Foundry landscapes? Many people. So there are, I guess, many experiences outside our SAP on how to operate landscapes. And I guess it's, in most of the cases, more than just one Cloud Foundry landscape. So we would be happy to get your feedback and ideas how you operate. As a small motivation for that one, if you remember the planting pot from the beginning of our slides and the seeds, so as some motivation to provide us ideas, feedback, we have brought, of course, some advertisement for SAP as well. We have brought a coffee mug and inside some seeds for various plants to keep our analogy running. If you're interested, if you have some ideas, feel free to grab one. I think, unfortunately, we won't have enough for all of you. But, yeah, I would say first come, first serve, feel free to grab. I think that's it for our talk, and I think, rest of the time we could use for Q&A. Any questions?
Do you have already an idea of what kind of white box monitoring you want to do?
So we have an ELK stack, which is currently already collecting the logs of all the other components. So let's say the rough idea would be we just have to find the pattern in the logs which would indicate a potential error and let's say would build an alert on that one. So still pretty rough and I think if you have thousands and millions of log lines, the interesting and difficult part is what is the pattern I have to search for? But that would be one of the tasks hop onto the ELK stack and put some alerting mechanism based on logs. So that certain patterns, messages in the logs would trigger an alert. So one tile here for a landscape would turn red or yellow, depending on if we see a certain pattern in the logs.
We also have, I mean, this is, let's say, the viewing part. We also have alerts based on, for example, Riemann already coming in, but they're not, let's say, integrated in this view. And it's somehow this shared view on the landscape status. This is something that we really find so valuable across the company. And so that's the question, how can you get more of these white box things in there, which also depending again, is it just a yellow or is it already a red when you see that, I don't know, when Bosch would report it's in meltdown state or so on. That's probably something you want to see red on that monitor, but that's something that we just can't integrate right now. So that's one of the things we would like to build to have just a more complete picture of the landscape. Yeah, so checking, okay, what of the Riemann stuff could really help color the tiles and what of these log-based patterns would indicate the status that you have to do something to fix the landscape.
Yes, we do. Let me quickly browse back to that slide here. I didn't mention that one while talking. So we have a tile per landscape, but on the very bottom, we have the infrastructure layer where you see our OpenStack, where you see the AWS, where you see Azure, not really updated slide here, so there's GCP as well. So we have a couple of monitors like resource limits in AWS, service limits, quota limits in OpenStack, whatever. So we have a couple of infrastructure monitors which we integrate here as well. For example, we have another one downloading just some binary from internet just to have some check of the bandwidth and the availability from our own data center to internet. So we are enhancing, let's say, the end user scenarios with some more technical checks to get a closer insight on, is the infrastructure causing Cloud Foundry not to work, or is it something inside Cloud Foundry? Until now, it's manual one, so we would have the alert, but it's still a manual scaling that we kind of at least to some extent by intention. So if, not, if we run out of resources, we always auto scale because that might be some app going crazy, some developer setting up a CI build, I don't know, deploying apps like hell because he's using a GUID and is always deploying a new app. So that, let's say, until now, we rather keep the safety of, we first check what is the reason why we have to scale, and then we scale. But yeah, it would have, let's say, on the other hand, would be nice to have some autoscaler, but yeah, we haven't found the right balance yet.
Yes, we have. So there's a, let's say, a distinction. So part of it is, of course, the platform, which is, let's say, what we are mostly concerned about. And then you have all the orgs and spaces for customers. And that is, let's say, managed by the commercial infrastructure at SAP. So customers can just buy and increase whatever they want to. And then we have to hurry up and buy the stuff at Amazon or Azure or so on. And then there's the scaling of the platform itself. And there, of course, whatever comes with the deployment, when the deployment says, I now need, I don't know, 3 large Postgres instances, okay, we provision that. So there's no quota on the platform coding itself.
Okay, okay. More questions? Or
more hunger?
Yeah. Okay, then. Thanks for joining. Thanks for taking the time.
Right.